thank the organizers, JEF, JEF, and PIDS for the invitation. I'm a trade economist, so the assignment that was given to me is something different. But I really enjoyed kind of looking into a new, to me, new issues. There are four questions. These are four questions the organizer gave me to respond to. So what I'd like to do is to give you my response to these four questions, or four points. And if I have some time left, I'd like to talk about inequality and innovation and globalization. First, what are the modes of the multilateral partnership for human capital development? So this is a human capital development. I guess the focus here is at ASEAN countries. As we heard already, there are various frameworks, multilateral, regional, and bilateral. These are economic cooperation in human resource development. And I just listed some, like UN, SDGs, and of course APEC, Hank mentioned this, as it's a human resource development program. I'm sure that ASEAN has some programs, and also, I don't know whether RCEP itself will have the program to deal with this human capital development, but I wish they do. And of course, area which I'm associated with, and PONS is associated with, provides technical assistance. And ODA, particularly through bilateral agreement, bilateral framework, many countries provide technical assistance. I just want to share with you one of my recent experiences that Vietnam and Japan are now cooperating to set up a so-called Vietnam-Japan University. And from Japan's side, there are about 10 universities in consortium, and my university is one of them. And we set up a graduate program last September, and they are going to set up an undergraduate program in 2020. So this is one of the more recent collaboration program between Japan and Vietnam. But through this joint program, Japan and I think Vietnam are hoping to provide not just technical assistance or education to Vietnamese students, but also other students from other ASEAN countries. And I think what is important for these international programs is to have cooperation, of course. For the recipient, if they, you know, they are receiving many programs from different sources, but it'll be more effective. This program will be effective if the programs are coordinated. And also, it has to be emphasized their own, the country's, recipient country's own program to educate their people. And for that, I guess the so-called ownership of the program is very important. So that's number one. Number two, connectivity issues prevent the formation of a people-centered ASEAN. First of all, what is people-centered ASEAN? Like I said, I've been working on trade issues. So us and economic community, among one of these three communities, the one that I've been working on. So I looked into ASEAN socio-economic, socio-cultural community blueprint 2025. And there, I think there's a definition of people-centered ASEAN. That is the ASEAN to empower people and also to promote equitable access to social protection, enjoyment of human rights, and so on. So after all, as I think we have already, it is a people who have to enjoy or benefit the from the any economic activities, including ASEAN's community building. And one of the issues is the connectivity, which we have already heard. Here, I'd like to emphasize the importance of people-to-people connectivity, people to people connectivity, and also access to information. And that these two kinds of activities should be emphasized. And then let me turn to the third question that is given. Will people-centered ASEAN play a leading role in regional integration? Yes, as I just said, people-centered ASEAN will benefit people, and if people feel that way, then they'll support, of course, the integration process. And that's how it should work, and of course, in the process, ASEAN identity will be nurtured. What about the this kind of approach to not only ASEAN, like I said, it should work for ASEAN, but what about ASEAN plus 3 or ASEAN plus 6? These are wider grouping. And in my view, maybe it's too premature for them to talk about identity. They are working hard to, first of all, to conclude RCEP, which will, of course, contribute to economic growth of this region. So once they are successful in concluding RCEP, maybe they can talk about East Asia identity. And like I said, it's maybe too premature at this moment. And then finally, I don't know why the organizers put this question in addition to three questions, which are related to people to people, but suddenly this is RCEP and TPP, but this is a question that I like to really respond to. But as we heard from Jayaseri-san, he is the chief negotiator for Malaysia, and I'm an outsider. So the information that I have is very limited, of course. As far as TPP-11 is concerned, it's almost done. I hope it will be done, signed early next year. Then 11 countries, at least 6 countries need to ratify TPP-11 to enact or to put the TPP-11 into action. And hopefully by 2019, in 1.5 years or so, I'd like to see the birth of TPP-11. Now, RCEP negotiation. Here again, I don't know who said this, but I think this leadership, I think maybe Jayaseri-san too. What I saw in TPP negotiation is, of course, U.S. led the first part of the negotiation, and then Japan joined. In my view, which may be biased, I think Japan contributed a lot to make TPP-12 reach a conclusion. But we don't see that in RCEP. I'd like to see, at least from my Japanese government side, I'd like to see stronger commitment from Prime Minister Abe. For whatever reason, I can guess some of the reasons why he's not as strongly supporting RCEP compared to TPP, but I'd like to see much more commitment, not only from him, but from other leaders. And that is what we need to conclude RCEP negotiation. Now, I have maybe 1 or 2 minutes left, so I'd like to talk about two. Thank you very much. 2 minute warning, so I have 2 minutes. And okay, so in the last session, very interesting session, about innovation and the inclusive growth. And I was going to ask Joseph about this question, which I didn't because of the time. Joseph talked about technological progress, innovation can be a source of growing inequality, income. But I didn't hear anyone talking about globalization. What about the relationship with globalization and technological progress? I think there are two-way causality. Why innovation? Because there are more competition coming from globalization. And then innovation leads to technological progress in communication and transportation services, which led to reduction in communication costs and transportation costs. So, advancement in innovation led to globalization. Globalization, in turn, promoted innovation. So I think I wanted to hear somebody mention about globalization, but I think the prescription which is given in the last session is fine. You know, it is, we should use innovation in a way to promote SMEs activities and so on, that which eventually will contribute to reducing income inequality. But then the last question I wanted to ask them is there's a more direct way of correcting or reducing income inequality. That is redistribution of income. You know, progressive income tax, inheritance tax. I know some countries don't have that this system yet, but let me just say in Japan, recently there is a policy from Mr. Abe's government to increase the extent of progressiveness, inheritance tax, progressive income tax, more people will be covered. So there's a trend in Japan toward, you know, improving income distribution using these tax policies. I just wonder how they are received in ASEAN countries, if they are discussing the possibility of, you know, introducing these mechanisms if they have, they don't have these mechanisms yet. So I just wanted to know more the opinions about introducing more direct way of redistributing income for ASEAN countries to improve the income inequality problem.